Maybe you know T-SQL or maybe you don't, but either way, have you heard of all the things that we've added to T-SQL recently? Learn all about it, including some demos of Greg's favorite one this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Greg Lowe. Greg, thanks so much for joining us today. Why don't you kick us off by telling us a little bit about what you do?
Hi, Anna. Yes, look, I'm a long-term data platform MVP. I think I've been 23 years in the platform now, or the program. And work predominantly with SQL Server. I've worked with it pretty much since it started. And I do a lot of just generally mentoring is the word I tend to use. I like to work with customers to get them to the point where they can do the work rather than me.
So. Awesome. I love that. Well, we're really excited to have you on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, we're going to be talking about what's new in T-SQL recently. And I'm really excited about this topic. And you and I were kind of talking about this before. Kind of an underrated space. Like maybe there's a lot of things people don't know about. So I'm just really excited to learn from you myself, Greg, as well. I'll just pass it over to you. What's new?
All good. Well, listen, so many people still sort of use the product like it was SQL Server 2000, but so very many things have changed over the years. There was a period around 2014, I think, where people felt like not much was happening. But since then, I don't think they've realized is quite a bit has changed in recent versions. But in particular, I want to call out the things that have happened since, let's say 2019 and more likely 2022. So there's a number of things I want to go through, the things that I think are the most important. And then what I want to do is show you my favorite one. So that's awesome. The plan. So listen, out of the new options, there's a whole lot of things. So is not distinct from. This one's kind of interesting. This is for checking sort of equivalence of values. And I'll show you that one in a minute because that is my favorite. This generate series got added a little while ago. And this is one where people often wanted like a table of numbers or things like that. So you wanted to be, in the simplest case, give me a table back that gives all the values from 1 to 10. But you could use this to generate series of dates, series of numbers, all sorts of things. Date truncation is a really, really important one. There's so many times I have things where, for example, I have a transaction and it's got a date and time and so on, but I want to bring it back to just the date, for example. But more importantly, perhaps, I want to bring it back to just the month and so on. And so while just getting rid of the time for a date is easy, getting rid of things like the days and stuff like that, that's much harder. And date trunk recently added does that sort of thing brilliantly. Date bucket allows you to take date values and sort of put them into buckets for analysis. And this is, again, another thing that's super popular. So if I said things like, I'd like to break all of these transactions into 2-hour chunks, where the chunks start at 15 minutes past the hour and so on. This is the sort of thing it can do. We've also had recently a number of approximate things added. Back a few versions ago, they added approximate for distinct counts and things like that. These are drastically faster than doing the actual calculation. And now we have those for percentiles. So percentile discrete and continuous. Those ones have now been added with approximate options that are radically faster than doing the full calculation. Named windows have been added in recent versions. And the beauty of this is that if you have an over clause as part of a windowing part of a query, you can now sort of, instead of having to repeat the whole thing the whole time, you can sort of use a name for it and then use the name again and again in a query. And you can derive new windows from old windows. It's wickedly cool. Their greatest and least appeared a little while ago in Azure SQL Database and now is in SQL Server 2022. This allows you to take a list of values and return the biggest or the least value. And this is actually something that was really messy to do before. And people often ended up with really quite awkward case statements and so on. Look, there are also a few enhancements. String split got an ordinal a while back. And the nice thing with that is, as well as being able to split a string, you can maintain the order, or you can do things like get me the third token out of a string. And so this is super powerful. LTrim, RTrim, and trim now have been extended. And in particular, you can choose the characters that will be trimmed out. So instead of just trimming white space on either side, let's say spaces, I often do things like I now define all of the Unicode white space characters, and I can trim all of those out just using a trim statement. And a number of the window clauses now have null treatment options. So if, for example, I am after the first value of a group or the last value of a group, previously, what would happen is if the first value was null, that's what you get back. But perhaps what you want is the first non-null value and so on. That now works. There's so much JSON love happening. And so we got a lot of JSON handling in SQL Server 2017, but this has been expanded quite a bit. So we got isJSON, we got JSON path exists. So this can check to see if a path exists within a piece of JSON. And we can form an array of JSON, and we can create objects in JSON. And there's more of this coming too. If you look around, you'll notice there have been previews announced on blog posts talking about even more JSON coming. And finally, the other one that I want to call out is bit manipulation. This is something we don't often do in T-SQL, but we've now got the ability to do shifting of bits in values and counting bits and getting bits and setting bits. So that's not something that was easy to do before at all.
So I have to ask a quick question. Can you tell me about bit shifting? That's not something I'm familiar with.
Yeah, so imagine where you have an integer value of the value, let's say 5, and it's a whole lot of zeros, and then 101. And if we shift them left, that 5, we end up doubling the value. That would be 10. And so we'd end up with an extra zero comes in on the right-hand side, and we throw away the bit at the top. That's but mostly people are doing that when they're having to interact with fairly low-level services or sometimes calling services that require you to, they maybe give you a mask where there's a whole lot of bits to indicate different values, but it's all stored inside a particular integer. It's a relatively common thing in those scenarios, but for the average person, mostly don't strike that too often. So, but what I do want to show you is my absolute favorite of all of these.
Awesome. Yeah, let's take a look. I'm super excited. I've already learned so many things that I had no idea we had done.
Oh, cool. So look, first up, if I look at this table here, I've got sales stock items, and notice I've got color sometimes. And so some of these things have colors. It's really, really common to want to write a query where, let's say it's part of a stored procedure and I have a parameter coming in and I say, yes, I want to go and find all the blue ones. And yes, that works exactly as you'd expect. But the problem has been, of course, if I use that sort of logic, where I say where color is at color, that doesn't work for null, right? So even though there's a whole lot that are null, we get nothing back. And that's because we have to say where color is null, rather than, because anything that's null, when you equate it, the value you get back is null, not true. And so what people often tried was something like this, where they'd say where is null color, make it an empty string equals is null at the parameter. And I mean, that works, right? So I mean, that would return it. But you can imagine that that doesn't optimize terribly well. And so even if you'd index the color column, that's not really going to work in the way you'd expect. And so if you look at, if we do this and I say, look, show me the execution plan, understand here, this is doing an index scan. So even though there's an index on color, it's actually reading the whole index, which is not exactly what we're after, right? So, and a more correct version, there's two problems with that. One is that first, that this is not logically equivalent, because whatever I put here, I can now no longer tell the difference between that and null. And maybe an empty string is a value that that has a meaning as opposed to not knowing the value. And so a better version has always been to say where color is at color, or color is null and at color is null. Now, I mean, that works, right? But again, it's the sort of thing that becomes really messy. And if you have a lot of columns, that really becomes something quite ugly. And so what the new option does, and it's been part of ANSI SQL for a long time, is I can now say where color is not distinct from at color. And so this says if they're both null, they're the same. If they're a value, they're the same, and so on. And it does it all for us. And so I can say, yep, that works for blue. And if I say leave it as null, works just the same. And so this is a thing of beauty, right? And if I look at the query plan, no, it's an index seek. So absolutely spot on what I want, right? Now, what I would, the thing that's funny about this one is that we nearly always use the command or the operator in the negative. So, I mean, there is an is distinct from, but most of the time you end up saying is not distinct from. One thing I'd love to convince the product group of is I'd love to be able to say this, where I could say we're color equal at color. But anyway, I'm trying to convince them of that. But the final thing is that if you run this command on a local server and you connect to a linked server and that one doesn't support the is distinct from and is not distinct from, this is actually what it generates under the covers. It actually sends this amazing piece of logic is what gets sent to the other end if you have a linked server and you're sending and you're running that command locally over data that's in a remote server. But anyway, it's kind of wicked.
Yeah, definitely a reason to try to get to the latest compat.
Indeed. And so, look, the thing I wanted to really say is that T-SQL is still evolving. It's a super valuable skill in the marketplace. And SQL Server 2022 adds a whole lot of interesting options. But if you really want to be an early adopter on this, of course, Azure SQL Database is where these things tend to appear before they appear anywhere else.
Awesome. Hey, Greg, thanks so much for coming on Data Exposed. I personally learned a ton. I know our viewers learned a ton. I also really enjoyed your favorite T-SQL enhancement. So thanks for sharing that with us. If you watch this episode, if you like this episode, go ahead and give it a like, leave us a comment, and let us know what your favorite T-SQL capability is that we've recently added. And check the link, check the description for some links to learn more. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.